Yes. In today's class, we'll see few more operations that can be performed on a lathe machine. Okay, so yesterday we had seen about the parts of a lathe and also the facing operation, where the facing operation is that we want to make the ends of the workpiece to be a flat surface, right? Okay, so next we'll go to the turning operation. Okay, now in this turning operation, so before going to these operations, I would just like to mention one thing. First thing is that on a lathe machine, whatever the type of operations that we are going to do, we will be able to do it in a cylindrical manner, in three-dimensional shape, or in circular cross-section only. Okay, right? Because the chuck is going to rotate, the workpiece attached to the chuck is also going to rotate. Okay, tool is stationary, tool is not going to rotate at all. We have to move it linearly only. Okay, so thereby, because of this, what is going to happen is that we will be able to get usually anything in circular cross-sectional shape only, right? Okay, so now let us see the turning operation. Now, for turning operation, what is this turning operation? Is that if we have a workpiece, a cylindrical workpiece in general, okay, we want to reduce the diameter of this. I don't need such a large diameter of the workpiece to be there. I just want a smaller diameter, okay, or I need it in the form of a step. I need it like this. I need it like this, like step. This is, say for example, diameter over here is 20 mm. This diameter over here is 30 mm. Okay, so I need it like this. So, but it will be in circular cross-section. So for this, what we have to do is, we have to remove the material onto the outside, that is onto the circumference. Okay, right? So we'll see how to do that. So in a turning operation, what is going to be done is that we can see here, where we can see a single point cutting tool having a sharp edge over here, right? So it is, that is why it is called single point cutting tool, okay, which is fixed to the tool post that is present over here. Okay, right. So the workpiece, this is the workpiece made up of aluminium metal, okay, is fixed to the chuck or the spindle. Okay, so if the chuck is going to rotate, the workpiece is also going to rotate. Okay, right. Now next, what do we need? How should we proceed? So first thing is that what we have to do is that the chuck should rotate so that the workpiece is going to rotate. First step. Second, then what we should do is we should get the tool closer to the workpiece. That means we have to move the tool in this particular direction so that the sharp tip of the cutting tool is going to come to the, is going to come in contact with the circumference of the workpiece. Okay, so for say for example, if the diameter over here is now 30 mm, okay, I want to reduce it by 2 mm, okay, or 5 mm. Okay, we cannot do it once for all 5 mm, 10 mm and all. We have to do it repeatedly in steps. Okay, so first we'll give the depth of cut, say for example 1 mm depth of cut, so the tool will be moved in into the workpiece for 1 mm, and then leave it there, and then after that we will move this tool parallel to the workpiece or the axis of the workpiece, okay, or the entire tool post carriage, everything is going to be moved along the length of the bed from one end to towards the chuck, from right from the tailstock end to the chuck. Okay, so for this what we have to do is, if we have to move it along the length of the bed, we have to rotate the carriage handle, okay, so that even the tool will also move along the length of the bed. Next, after this, once when we do this thing, what is going to happen? Already the tool has gone in a depth for 1 mm. Okay, so then it is going to, when we move the tool in this particular direction, it is going to remove 1 mm of material in this complete length, so diameter is going to reduce. Okay, so this is how the turning operation is going to be performed. We'll see how it happens in this video. Okay, so first they will see the point, that is they'll place the tip of the cutting tool to be very close to the circumference of the workpiece. So then they will take it little bit behind, just a small distance. They'll start the spindle. Okay, and now here we can see that the tool is now outside the workpiece. There's a gap over here. Okay, they'll go in for 1 mm depth of cut. They'll push the tool, that is they'll make use of the cross slide so that the tool will move towards the axis of the workpiece for the required depth of cut. Okay, and after that, then the cross slide is not touched, and then the next thing is that now they're slowly getting the workpiece towards the, sorry, they're slowly getting the tool towards the workpiece. So this gap is now going to gradually decrease. That means they're moving the tool along the length of the workpiece. Okay, so you can see here the slowly the gap is reducing, and once the tip of the tool touches the workpiece, the material is going to be removed in the form of the chips. So slowly they are moving it along the length of the workpiece. The tool is now come in contact with the workpiece. So now the material on the outermost surface is being removed for the required depth of cut. So they are slowly at a constant speed, the tool post is being moved. So previously the tool was here, but now after moving in this particular direction, it is now situated over here. Okay, so here we can see a clear shade, a one line that is still here. It has been machined, and for this complete length, okay, the required depth of cut it's been done, and turning operation is performed for this particular length, and so much amount of material is being removed. So we will have a larger diameter over here. Since material is removed in this particular portion, the diameter will be comparatively less than this, right? So this is called as turning operation, where we want to have cylindrical shape. Okay, cylindrical shape, we want to have cylindrical work pieces. So if you want to have some more, we want to reduce the diameter furthermore, take back the tool outside, that is outside the length of the workpiece, give the depth of cut once again, and then move the tool along the length of the workpiece once again, right? So we will be removing some more material, right? The chips are removed. Right, so this is how the turning operation is being performed on a lathe machine. So they'll get the tool closer to it once again, if at all we need to perform it, perform the turning operation once again, right? So they'll give the next depth of cut, start the spindle. So tool will be moving, first will be given for depth of cut. That is they'll rotate the cross, they'll move the cross slide, okay? And then the tool is going to move along the length of the workpiece. So yes, now it has made the contact with the tool and the workpiece is in contact, and material is being removed. A very small depth of cut has been given. That is why a fine thickness of chips are being formed. Okay, right? And you can see that the material is being removed. So once the material is removed, the diameter in this case for this turning operation is going to reduce. Right? Okay. So this is about turning operation. Next. Okay, so next we shall see about the next type of operation is called as the grooving operation. Yeah. So say for example, if you want to cut a portion of the material, we want to cut it here into two pieces, or we want to have a step. Say for example, if you look at this, it is cylindrical like this, right? I don't need like this. I need the workpiece to be like this. Here there should be a step. That means diameter should be less over here. Okay. Here I need 30 mm diameter. Here I need 30 mm diameter. But only in this region, the diameter should be 20 mm. So that means I have to remove so much of material only in this particular place. Okay. So for this, a single point cutting tool, what we have used for turning operation, is not suitable. We have to change the tool, which is called as a grooving tool. Okay. We'll see that grooving tool during the operation. Right. Yes. So grooving tool will look like this. Sorry. A grooving tool will look like this. It will have a little bit broader for about 3 to 4 mm or even 5 to 6 mm of thickness, having a sharp tip. Okay. Having a sharp tip. Okay. So this is a grooving tool that is present over here. Right. Okay. So next we'll see this. So first thing is that we'll have to mark where we want to perform the grooving, at what distance. So those markings will be done. Okay, so the spindle is rotating. That means the workpiece is also going to rotate. And look here, once they rotate this handle, the cross slide, the tool is going to move towards the axis of the workpiece. So here, what is going to happen is that the tool is going to move in this particular direction, which has already got such a larger width with a sharp tip. So once this has been moved towards the axis of the workpiece, the material is going to be removed, which you can see here in the form of chips. Okay, right. So what is going to happen? We are going to have a larger diameter over here. And since material has been removed, it is going to be a smaller diameter in this place, having a groove. So here now you can see that there's a larger diameter and a smaller diameter. A depth of groove is being formed onto the workpiece. If we further give the depth of cut, yes, then still the diameter is going to reduce. And finally, once it reaches the axis of the workpiece, the workpiece or the model is going to be into two different pieces. Right? So this is called as grooving operation. So if you want to have the grooving depth to be, the grooving width to be more, I want this to be here also, we can move this tool post so that the tool is over here and perform the operation, the grooving operation, so that again material will be removed in this particular region. So sometimes they will also use a coolant to reduce the friction, because heat will be generated. Okay, the workpiece as well as the tool will be heated. So to avoid this, okay, so a coolant will be used. So here we can see constantly a depth of cut is being given. That means the tool has been moving towards the axis of the workpiece and material is being removed in the form of chips that we can see here, right? Okay, and ultimately what's happening here, the diameter is gradually reducing because the tool is getting inserted, right? So now you can see here that the diameter is very, very less over here when compared to the other areas. So performing this, giving constantly the depth of cut, okay. So just look here, it's going to rotate only this cross slide so that the tool is going to move towards the axis of the workpiece. And slowly it has to be rotated at a constant speed, okay. Right, so this requires skill to operate the machine. Only then we will be able to get good surface finish. So it is now cut into two pieces. Now you can see here, it has been made into two pieces. So this is the place where it was cut, right? So it has now been separated. Okay, so this is about grooving operation. Okay, so next we shall see the other operations. That is, we'll go for 1 second. Okay, yes, now we shall go for taper turning operation, where we want to have a conical surface. Okay, a conical surface. How to do taper turning operations? Okay, right. So if you look at this, here the diameter is smaller, here the diameter is smaller, and here the diameter is large. That means it's a conical surface. How to get these things, how to perform these operations? So to get this, the operation is called taper turning operation. We'll see that how to do it. So we'll fix the workpiece into the chuck. So here is the jaws of the chuck. So this is the jaw, 3 or 4 jaws will be there. Okay, and once we tighten up over here, this jaws will hold the workpiece. So yes, switch on the machine, right? So the first thing is that the facing operation. Okay, so first thing is that we have to flatten the ends of the workpiece. So what we have to do here is that the tool should be moving towards the axis of the workpiece. Okay, and we can see that the material for this thickness is being reduced. Diameter is going to reduce, as well as the length of the material is also going to reduce, right? So there is only one thing, the tool is just straight away moving towards the axis of the workpiece till the center, and that's it. So you can see now a flat workpiece that has been obtained. Okay, that is facing operation, right? So next we'll go for taper turning. In taper turning operations, we have different ways of doing this operation. One of them is by adjusting the compound slide, okay, or rotating the compound slide method. Okay, there are 5 methods. One of the method is adjusting the compound slide method. So what is this compound slide method? I'll tell you. So we'll first loosen up the screw. Okay, I'll just show you here. So what you can see over here, sorry, this particular piece of rectangle over here is the cross slide. Here you can see this white color portion graduated with degrees, 5 degrees, 1 degree, 2 degree, and so on. Okay, just like our protractor. And what you can see about that, this particular rectangular piece is the compound slide, and the handle for the compound slide is over here. So what we can do here is that we can rotate this rectangle, okay, which is now like this. We can have it in this particular angle. We can rotate it, okay. And about this compound slide, the person who has kept his hand over here, this is nothing but the tool post. And here we have one tool which we'll see later on. Okay, there's another tool fixed over here. So if the compound slide is rotated, then the tool is also going to be rotated like this, right? Because the tool post is resting onto the compound slide, right? So we'll see that how it has been performed. Right. Okay. So yes, he has just what they did is that. So he is going to loosen the nut, and only then we'll be able to rotate the compound slide. So they rotate the compound slide, okay, and to the required angle. There's one small line that is present over here, which marks for which angle are we rotating. Okay, this is the compound slide. Sorry, this is the compound slide. Okay, and this is the handle. So now what has happened, since the compound slide is rotated, even the tool is also being rotated like this, which was previously like this. It is now moved to this particular angle, right? So rotate it to the required angle, tighten this nut over here, okay, so that the angle will not change. So here we can see the angles that has been marked, okay, 5 degrees, 10 degrees, 15, 20, 30, and so on. So we can also rotate it the other way. We can also have it in this particular manner, like this also we can have. Okay. Okay, now look at this. Previously, this compound slide was like this. Now it is at an angle. Right? It is at an angle. Right. So for they fix this, workpiece is already fixed to the chuck. Okay. Yes. So now just look at this. If you look at this, the workpiece axis is over here. Okay. The compound rest is rotated like this. This is the angle theta formed. Right. So now if the tool is over here, if this is the tool, the tip of the tool, if it is over here, it is closer. This is the distance. So if I rotate this handle, the tool is going to move along this line. Okay, right? The workpiece is going to rotate. So tool is going to move along this line, no more parallel to the workpiece. Now see the distance. If the tool tip is over here, it is closer to the workpiece. If the tool tip is over here, just look at the distance, right? That means you are going to get a conical shape. Okay, right? Okay, so we'll see the operation now. So it's going to rotate only the compound rest. So first get the tool closer to the workpiece, touch the circumference of the workpiece, give a small depth of cut, start the spindle. And now rotate only this compound rest handle, nothing else. Okay, now rotate only this compound rest handle so that it moves linearly. Now you can see that because of that rotating of the compound rest, the tool is going to move away from the axis of the workpiece, from one side to another side. So you can clearly see that you're going to get a inclined line. So he's just rotating only this compound rest angle, and the tool is moving like this, no more parallel to the workpiece, right? So thereby we'll be able to get a conical shape, okay, which is called by taper turning operation. Okay, so only for taper turning operation, this compound rest has to be rotated to the required angle. There's a small calculation for that, which I'll touch upon later on. It's a very small step. Okay, and this step, if you have to say, for example, we need, and this step is to be performed repeatedly, okay, if we need a smaller diameter, if we need a very small diameter over here, and here it has to be like this, okay, then this has to be done repeatedly. The tool has to be used again and again. First pass, second pass, third pass, and so on, so that we get the required smaller diameter at one end and bigger diameter at the other end. So for this, we have to do the calculation. So we have to find out what is the angle theta. Okay, so this is about taper turning operation. Right. Yeah, one second. See this. One second. Okay, yes. So here is the you can see the calculation to find out the angle. Okay, right? So we should know capital L, length of the job, that is length of the workpiece from one end to other end. What should be the smaller diameter and what should be the bigger diameter? Okay, so if we know that, then we can calculate this. Okay, so length the taper length. So what is this taper length? Is nothing but capital L is nothing but this axis length. Okay, taper length is this. This is the taper length, right? So if we have to find out this, then we need the length of the job, nothing but for what is the linear distance from end to end. Okay, the tapering distance. Okay, say for example, if I take a cone, okay, this is the axis. So this line is nothing but capital L. This is the taper length, small l. Okay, so over here, right, capital L into larger diameter minus smaller diameter divided by 2 times the taper length will give us the, right? So this is the formula that has to be used to rotate the compound rest. Okay, so one more in this it's getting time up, so I'll do the remaining methods in the next class. The different methods of here. We'll continue this. So here we have the. Here you can see the taper turning method taper turning operation by compound rest slider using the compound rest or the compound slide. So what is going to happen? You can see that here is the axis of the workpiece. Okay, tool, the compound rest is now rotated. It is no more parallel to the axis. You can see that very well. Okay, this is the angle. So now if we move this compound rest, okay, it is going to move in this particular direction, forming a tapered section, right? As they rotate, only the compound rest is going to move. Okay, it's about the compound rest. Okay, so I'll stop here for today. I'll continue in the next class.